The LM741 is an overrated, outdated op-amp, and it is a terrible choice for most circuits. And yet for years now, people have been leaving comments asking over and over again, will this circuit work with an LM741? The answer is usually no. But in this video, I'm going to talk about why the 741 won't work, and why it's considered to be out of date. We're going to talk about op-amp non-idealities like voltage swings, input offset voltage, slew rate, and gain bandwidth product. These properties limit the performance of an op-amp, and ultimately determine whether or not a given amplifier is going to work in your circuit. If you don't understand what op-amp non-idealities are, you're not going to be able to design and debug an op-amp circuit. So I'm going to help you with that. But first, let's give this thing some props. The MUA741, or the LM741, was one of the first op-amps ever made. It was groundbreaking for its time, and it was very popular in the 1970s. It was an all-in-one amplifier solution replacing discrete transistor designs. It saved space, it saved power, it cut down on manufacturing costs, and most importantly, if you used it, you didn't have to spend hours of your time designing an amplifier from scratch. And to this day, many people still have great nostalgic love for this thing. Unfortunately, some of the engineers from that era who decided to get into teaching never bothered to learn about newer op-amps. This led to the situation we have today where beginners are being taught to use silicon dinosaurs in their circuits. I'll talk more about that at the end of the video, but right now I would like to transition to the main focus of this video, which is teaching you about op-amp non-idealities. First, let's talk about voltages. The 741 series requires a minimum power supply voltage of 20 volts, or plus and minus 10 volts. It's very rare nowadays to have such a voltage readily available, and having to boost the voltage just to use an op-amp is stupidity with extra steps. Not only is the minimum supply voltage a problem, but I want to introduce you to the concept of op-amp output voltage swing. Here I have an LM741 configured as an inverting amplifier with a gain of 10. The power supply is set to plus and minus 10 volts, which meets the 20 volt minimum requirement. And I'm using my waveform generator to inject a 1 kHz, 1 volt peak-to-peak sine wave into the amplifier circuit. Since the amplifier has a gain of 10, 1 volt on the input should give us a 10 volt sine wave on the output. And as expected, it does. It's very nice, actually. But watch what happens when we increase the input voltage to 2 volts. You would think we'd get a 20 volt sine wave on the output, but nope, not even close. Take a look at what's happening on the top and bottom of the waveform. The voltage is trying to swing up to the plus 10 volts, but it's getting limited by the 741. The 741 output is only able to swing within 0.8 volts of the 10 volt supply rail, limiting the top of our sine wave to 9.2 volts. The situation is even worse on the bottom half of the sine wave. Instead of having an amplifier that can output minus 10 volts, our 741-based amplifier can only swing as low as minus 8.8 volts. Well, that sucks. If we look at the datasheet, we can see that the output of an LM741 typically only swings within a volt or two of the power supply rails. And the output swing gets worse depending on how heavy the load is. Look at how much worse it gets when I add or remove a 1 kΩ resistor as a load. Now, I don't want to get into detail in this video, but it's also worth mentioning that not only is output voltage swing an issue, but input voltage swing is also an issue. Imagine an op-amp that can't amplify signals that are too close to the circuit's ground. Not good. Okay, well, instead of having to deal with all these power supply and voltage swing issues, how about we just use a different op-amp? Instead of the op-amp that your lazy professor recommended to you, I'd like to introduce you to one of my favorite op-amp families, the MCP6000X series. It supports rail-to-rail input and output voltage swing. This means that you can use them right up to the edge of your power supply rails on both the input and the output. The power supply can be between 1.8 volts and 6 volts, which is perfect for modern electronics. The MCP6000 series op-amps are available in a wide variety of packages, and they cost almost nothing. So you can use them as a hobbyist, and you can use them in commercial designs. I've done it. I promise this is not an advertisement, I just really like these chips, and they are my default go-to op-amp for anything low power and low frequency. Okay, let's move on to another non-ideality. Input offset voltages. I have an LM741 here configured as an amplifier with a gain of 10. I'm going to connect the circuit ground to the input of this amplifier, and 0 volts in, multiplied by 10, should give us 0 volts out. Let me connect my multimeter to measure the output, and we get 15 millivolts on the output. Well, that's pretty close to zero. It might as well be background noise, right? Okay, let's change the amplifier a little bit. Let's swap out one of the resistors and make it an amplifier with a gain of 100, and let's see how much it amplifies 0 volts. And it turns out we get 0.15 volts. It's starting to look like something is wrong here. This circuit is worse at math than Joe Rogan. Okay, so what's going on here? The answer is that an LM741 has an input offset voltage of about 1 millivolt. What that means is that instead of your amplifier amplifying like this, what you actually get is an additional 1 millivolt DC being added to the inverting or non-inverting pin of your op-amp. That doesn't sound like much until you're amplifying it by 100, and all of a sudden now you have 100 millivolts appearing out of nowhere. This might not be a big deal in a circuit that's amplifying AC by 2x, but it is something you need to be aware of with high-gain designs. You sometimes see the input offset voltage modeled like this, or like this, and it can even be a negative offset voltage. The point is that with any op-amp, you have a small unwanted DC voltage difference between the inverting and non-inverting inputs. This will get amplified, whether you like it or not. And on a 741, it's especially bad. Also, similar to how the input offset voltage is a non-ideality, there's also another non-ideality called input offset current, or bias currents. I'm not going to go into detail on that in this video, but I will say that this does become significant when working with low-powered circuits, or circuits that have to amplify tiny signals, like in electrocardiographs or electromyography. So anyway, let's swap out this silicon dinosaur with something better. Let's use an op-amp that can handle similar supply voltages as a 741, but it has a better input offset voltage specification. Let's use a TLC081. The TLC81 has an input offset voltage of about 400 microvolts. That's way better. And pin for pin, it's a drop-in replacement for a 741, so I don't need to change anything on my breadboard. Now when we measure the output voltage, it's minus 20 millivolts. Much closer to the theoretical 0 volts it should be. In general, the TLC81 is a decent choice for circuits around the 12 volt range. And all of the op-amps I mention in this video are so basic that you can buy them from pretty much anywhere. If you have a class project that requires an op-amp, and things just aren't working out with the one your professor recommended, try a different one from this video. Next, let's talk about an op-amp slew rate. The LM741 has a slew rate of only 0.5 volts per microsecond, which means it can't handle fast-changing signals well, and it'll introduce distortion into the output signal. And I think the best way to explain that is to just show it to you. Here I have an LM741 configured as a non-inverting amplifier, and it's amplifying a 10 kHz sine wave by approximately 3. On the input, I'm feeding it a 5-volt sine wave, and it's amplifying it to a little over 15 volts, exactly as you would expect. Now, watch what happens when I increase the frequency of my input sine wave. At around 16 kHz, it starts looking a lot less rounded. Now, if I increase the frequency to 20 kHz, it's not even a sine wave anymore. It's become a triangle wave. I'm not trying to make a guitar distortion circuit here, so this op-amp has problems. Zooming in a little, notice the slope on the waveform here. The op-amp is limited in terms of how fast it can change the output voltage. It's only able to change the output voltage by up to 600 millivolts every microsecond. This is the slew rate of an op-amp. It's the upper limit of the slope of the output voltage versus time. On a 741, the datasheet says the slew rate is 0.5 volts per microsecond, so we actually kind of lucked out getting 0.6 volts per microsecond. Now, that's actually pretty terrible by modern standards, and in a minute I'll show you some better op-amps that won't distort your sine waves. But first, let's talk about one more non-ideality, the op-amp's gain bandwidth product. This limits the frequency response of the op-amp. On a 741, the gain bandwidth product is around 1 MHz. If you're new to electronics, you might think, oh, okay, it can amplify up to 1 MHz, so it's more than enough for audio. Well, no. Gain bandwidth product of 1 MHz means that the gain multiplied by the bandwidth has to be less than 1 MHz. In other words, if you rearrange this equation, if you, for example, have a gain of 25, it means that you can only have amplification bandwidth of 40 kHz. You would only get the full 1 MHz bandwidth if your circuit had a gain of 1, i.e. no amplification at all. Let me show you what that looks like. It's the same non-inverting amplifier as before, but this time we have a theoretical gain of about 56. Now I know that's a little high for an amplifier, but it makes for an impressive demonstration of gain bandwidth product limitations. On the input, I'm feeding it a 100 millivolt peak-to-peak sine wave at 1 kHz. And on the output, we're getting 5.6 volts. Now I'm going to increase the input sine wave frequency, and I want you to look carefully at what happens to the amplitude of this sine wave. Okay, did you see that? When we went from 1 kHz to 4 kHz, we went from 5.6 volts peak-to-peak to 5.5 volts peak-to-peak. So we're already losing a measurable amount of gain at just 4 kHz. Let's take this even further. Watch what happens when I increase the input frequency from 4 kHz to 10 kHz. When we started, we had a gain of about 56, but now at 10 kHz, our gain has dropped to about 47, and it's just going to get worse and worse as we increase the frequency. If you've studied filters before, you might recognize that what we have here is an unintentional low-pass filter. Now, 4 kHz, 10 kHz, it's not like these are high frequencies here. There are op-amps out there that can do over 100 MHz video signals. This is just cringe. I also really want to stress something here. Notice that this is not a slew rate problem like before. The sine wave is beautifully rounded like it should be, it's just not getting amplified like it should be at higher frequencies, because of the gain bandwidth product limitation. Now you know what the difference between slew rate and bandwidth limitation looks like, you're going to be in a better position to debug your op-amp circuits in the future. So yeah, the LM741 can sort of work for audio if you get all the power supply voltages just right, and you adjust the offsets just right, and you don't amplify things too much, but really, no sane person is going to bother with this. Do you want a better op-amp for audio? Check out the NE5532. Or, even better, the LM4562. This thing is really nice. It's expensive, but it destroys a 741 in every way. And by now, you should be able to understand enough of the datasheet to see why. Okay, so far we've talked about voltage swings, offset voltages, slew rate, and gain bandwidth product. But there are way more non-idealities in op-amps. Far too many for one video. If you want to learn about things like common mode rejection ratio and input noise, check out these videos on the EEVBlog. There are thousands of different op-amps to choose from. And if you're actually serious about analog electronics engineering, you're going to have to spend a lot of time on DigiKey seeing what's out there. YouTube and textbooks are not a substitute for sitting down on a bench and experimenting. Alright, I'm going to say a few more things before the video ends. The LM741 is obviously going to have some niche applications where it's the right choice. If you have a potato sack full of recycled 741s from a supplier in China, and they cost less than a penny each, and your circuit maxes out at 1 kHz, then yeah, maybe the 741 is the right choice for your product. But there are way, way too many people out there on YouTube and in real life who are introducing the 741 to students like it's the default op-amp you should know about, and it isn't. It just confuses the hell out of students, and then they come to me asking why things aren't working. The 741 is a great tool for teaching the non-idealities of op-amps, but half the lectures I see using it are not teaching the non-idealities of op-amps. Technology changes over time, and in my opinion, if someone doesn't update their knowledge over several decades, that's a red flag. In general, you should always double-check what they're teaching you in university, regardless of what you're studying.